Welcome to Dead Man's Party. Nostalgic reviews from the 70s, 80s, and 90s. With your hosts, Chris, Alex, and Christian. Who could ask for more? Don't run away, it's only them.
Hello, this is Burt Young. You listen to the Skeleton Crew, and I don't sweat you.
That's right, you heard it. Welcome to the very first Dead Man's Party. This is where we take our non-horror nostalgic trip down memory lane, where we talk about all of our favorite 70s, 80s, and 90s movies. We wanted to start this one big, and you really can't get much bigger, so we're excited about this one. You know me, my name is Al. Let me introduce the guys. Chris, what's up, brother?
What's up, man? Give me 20 seconds. 20 seconds just to fanboy out here for a second, okay?
Oh, boy.
So I'm sitting here with two of my three favorite horror movie podcasters of all time talking about not a horror movie, but my favorite fucking movies ever. Ever made, and it's mind blowing. So, thank you for having me.
And Brandon's your third favorite.
My third favorite will go unnamed, so I don't hurt anybody's feelings.
That was out.
I wonder if that dream show will ever come true. We'll see. But you heard him. It's Christ Ian. How are you, man?
I'm doing great. Thank you. Yeah, that's a stupid Facebook name, but oh well. What am I going to do?
Christian from Exploding Heads, it is an honor, dude. I don't think you've ever been on the Skeleton Crew, right, or anything like that.
No, I've never been on this show, and you've just been on ours, I think, twice now.
Twice
in all these years.
Right. All these years. It's only been almost 10 years, or 10.
And Christian, let me apologize to you that Alex and I had you come on a second tier podcast to record this. We are mere peasants here to serve you, oh great one.
Oh, wait, I've always said that we were a fourth tier podcast, or did I make a joke about this? Because I do throw out shade to everybody.
When we recorded Silent Night, Deadly Night, and Dave was talking about me busting my podcast cherry with Alex, you said, oh, he had to go on a second tier podcast first. Fucking prick.
I did say that. Yeah, I owed up to that. Yeah,
he had to work his way up to the Exploding Heads.
Yeah.
I came out of nowhere, and now he's been on like every podcast known to man.
Yeah, I know. Suddenly he's like the most popular guy in the network. What if we had one? But yeah, we're doing Rocky today. It's a Rocky retrospective, guys. Now this just came out of nowhere. Chris always wanted to talk about Rocky, and you know, me and him have been talking, and now here we are. We're going to explore the whole Rocky frame, all three of us. Christian's going to be there for all of them. It's going to be a team effort. We're going to knock all these out, Rocky 1 through 5 and Rocky Balboa. We are not continuing on with the Creed movies, though. So
good.
Not that I don't like them, but I just don't have
the
energy.
Well, the first two are good. I didn't like the third one, though.
I like the third the most.
Oh.
Hey! Alex, I'm with you. I thought so, too.
You all are fucking crazy!
I know. We are in the minority.
The only thing good about that movie was the bad guy. Everything else sucked.
Yeah, there's Chris's stuff. Maybe we will do the Creed movies.
Yeah, maybe we should if we're going to get that worked up. So let's talk about Rocky, though. 1976. How did you guys get introduced to Rocky? How old were you when you first watched this, and how?
So I don't remember exactly how old I was when I first saw it, but my mother has a picture of me wearing a Rocky t-shirt when I was 5 years old, and I was born in 1975. So I had to have seen it by 1980 because the first two movies had come out at that point. And I have a vivid memory of seeing part three in the theater with my dad when I was 6 years old. And I was obsessed ever since then.
Lucky, man. How about you, Christian?
I honestly think it was roughly the same time frame. I'm like 1 year older, and I think it was, I think it was 1980, because that would have meant two movies came out. There's a small possibility I saw Rocky II in the theater with my parents.
Rocky II?
Yeah, because they took me to movies. I saw Star Wars when – I'm not sure if I saw Star Wars on the first run, but I definitely saw it multiple times on the second run when it came out with – in 79 again, or when it got re-released. So
yeah,
I'm almost
on the second
positive
run in a drive-through or drive-in.
And I'm 99% sure, but with my mom wouldn't be able to remember. My dad's long gone. So I just know that they took me to see these films, and I from definitely three and above in the theater.
Wow.
I'm almost positive, I guess I should say, that I saw two in the theater. But if not, it would have been 80. No question.
Well, you guys are lucky. Not that I was unlucky. I was just younger, so mine was obviously different. Back in the 80s, my dad, he was the cool guy because he was one of the people who dubbed tapes when you rent them at the video store. So it was a big deal. Like, you just rent them, and now we have all these movies, and you otherwise couldn't afford them, I guess, at that time. So the earliest memory I have is that we had all four Rockies on dubbed tapes, VHS, and I know I watched Rocky V in theater. That was the first one I saw in theater. So I guess it was already 1985 by the time I started watching them, right? Because that was Rocky IV, right?
Yep.
So I think, yeah, that's when I got into it. And I'd like to say that even as a kid, I always really loved part one and two, which is a weird thing because kids probably didn't, right? Like, they were so excited about Rocky III and IV. But as a kid, I really appreciated the character study of part one and two. And even like the quote unquote boring parts of part two, like I was in there and I was living the moments out with the characters. So like I never just liked the extravagant ones. So Rocky One was always a big thing for me. And I'm happy to talk about it. I never really talked about it in depth with anybody, really.
No, neither have I. Neither have I, funny enough. And similar story. Like, I knew it was, even at a young age, knew it was the most real movie in the sense of, like, it's not what it became. But as I got older, I actually ended up watching probably part three and four the most. For the most. The most. I agree with you. He just had a way, even though he didn't direct the first one, probably from the way he structured the story, I found it very relatable, even as a like 5 or 6 year old.
It's weird.
Most likely 6 year old kid. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's obvious why a kid or a young teen would be drawn more to parts three and four, because those are way more bombastic and they're like action movies almost. Just shit going on constantly. Whereas one and two are basically just like dramas.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
For sure.
But I learned to appreciate those movies at a young age, and they never bored me or anything like that. I was fully invested in those.
Right. And it's funny that Christian says that. He makes me realize, although I was invested and cared and appreciated it, I still, when I wanted to watch a Rocky movie as I got older in my teens and 20s, I still went to part three and four. One and two became the least watched easily.
Yep.
Five is kind of like somewhere between both sets. So like it's a weird thing. As much as you appreciate it, when you're in the mood for, I want to see a Rocky movie, man, you put on three or four. That's just how it is. Now, but as you get older, I think you kind of come back down to earth and you're like, wait a minute, you know? And especially when people appreciate Rocky Balboa, they're obviously, what they're appreciating is part one or part two more than three or four, obviously, right? So, I mean, Creed 2, I imagine, is what would be more for the Rocky 3, 4 fan.
Creed 2 should have been called Creed 2: Rocky 4 Part 2. It really should have.
Right.
Creed and Rocky IV, too.
Exactly. Right.
Yeah.
So let's talk about Rocky. What is it about this? So it's your favorite movie ever. I guess we'll start with you, Chris. So
yes.
Why is this movie your favorite movie compared to, and I know nobody even knows this about you yet. He's a huge movie guy. This guy will watch 5 movies in one night. He'll have a whole thing that he has traditions where every Thanksgiving he'll watch these 5 movies, every Christmas these are on specific days. On his birthday he watches certain movies. Like this guy is the movie guy. So how does this rise to the top out of all these things you're so passionate about?
As far back as I can remember, when I watch the Rocky movies, I get so sucked in. I really feel it's almost like I'm watching a documentary, almost like not a documentary, but like he's actually a real person. Like even when I see Stallone interviewed,
like City of Philadelphia, I thought he was. I kept his statue up for fucking years.
No, seriously, like when I see Stallone interviewed, like on that Netflix documentary that came out recently, he's Rocky to me. He's not Sylvester Stallone. He's Rocky. Like that character is so real to me and so near and dear to my heart. It's hard to even put into words. I don't know. It's so relatable. Not that I'm a boxer or anything, but he's just such a normal guy and so charming yet so stupid. I mean, I don't know. You know what I mean?
Because lived it. I think because it's him. Because it's, again, instead of boxing, take acting. And he was living that life. He was trying to fight to make it. And again, not to get in the bad story, but I'm just saying, and I think that's why, kind of like you're saying, documentary in a sense, like it mirrors his life at the time and the underdog. We are sucker for the underdog story. And this is what, like, I guess like On the Waterfront and Marty were influences, but I'm saying that just became the underdog story for us, our generation. And I think I've always been a sucker for it. So now anytime a movie comes out about the underdogs, I love it. Like Same the here. Underdog fighting back, and the speeches that we get to, they're all throughout this, whether it's Mick saying something, whether it's him, his speech in part 6, Adrian, like everybody has a moment in this where they've got these words of wisdom that you're just like, fuck yeah, like fist pumping moments in a sense. And it starts here, but you're right. This is like the humble beginnings. They try to make him as likable as possible, considering, even though he's like, I'm watching it kind of in the background here while we're talking, because why not? And he's doing the shakedown, because I forget this stuff. When you come back to revisit the movie, you forget that to make some money, he's working for, you know,
Gazzo.
He's a collector. He's got to go break thumbs, but he won't do it. That's what makes him the nice guy.
Exactly. He's such a good guy. He can't even do that.
Yeah, and I don't want that to get confused. Like, I was talking to Chris earlier. He's not like some gangster with like, oh, but he's got a heart of gold and stuff. That's not really what Rocky is. Like, he's just a down and out loser, honestly. Like, he's not smart. He's not good. He's a bum.
Yeah.
He really is. And so is Adrian. So is Paulie. So is Mickey. They're all down and out losers. They have nothing going for them. The only person who remotely has anything going for them is Gazzo and Apollo and his team, right? Like, no one that we're watching has anything going for them. So, like, there's a lot in the character study.
Buckus.
Yeah, Buckus is actually doing well for a dog. Better than Rocky is for a human. You see his apartment?
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, and of course, everyone's going to be expecting us to get into the whole creepy creepy moment with Adrian.
When he corners her?
And he has his armpits sticking out, and he's like, hey, listen, where are you going, Adrian? I just want to talk to you. No, I really should be. No, I think you should stay. Like, remember how people got all freaked out about Baby, It's Cold Outside, that song? Like, this is the living embodiment of that song.
We could TikTok this tonight. And just say, can you believe this movie? Look at this scene. And it would be a sensation. And they're going to want to cut it like they're wanting to do Gone with the Wind or something like this. Right. It's just, people are so fucking sensitive. Well, you're right. Take the scene out of context. It's weird. But that was like, yeah, that's exactly it. The Baby, It's Cold Outside comparison sums it up.
I mean, he corners her in his apartment. basically, by the door and slides her down the wall.
And he says, take these off. Now I'm going to kiss you, all right? She's like, And he's like, yeah, just be quiet. I'm going to kiss
you. And he starts singing, Baby, It's Cold Outside.
Hey, yo, baby.
But even when he was on the stairs, supposedly when they filmed that, the police thought something weird was going on. Like, supposedly.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so they didn't know that. Yeah, they thought something, like, strange was going on while they were filming the scene where he kept going, come on, come in. He kept pushing the door open. Yeah. Oh, dude, that's the funniest thing. Yeah, it's so weird how you ever thought that was right, you know? Like, it's not even about political bullshit. Like, it's like, I'm just wondering how you ever thought this was, because I don't know when, even in the 90s, before all this stuff came up, I don't know if I would have been like, hey, let me do this to this girl in this movie, and like, okay, why are you doing that? Why don't you just have a normal talk with her and, you know, have her, like, want to kiss you? It's like, I don't know, I want to do it this way. Like, it's just the funniest part. But
he's like, hey, you want to sit down on this couch? It's a nice couch. I don't know.
Yeah, looks like it's fucking maggot infested.
Yeah, but there's bugs on that side, so the couches are safer. Yeah,
there's big bugs over there. Yeah. I like how they're just in one part of his room, too. They don't just fly around. yeah, so let's just talk about some great moments in the movie. Like, one of them that really sticks out, we're not doing this in order. This ain't going to be, like, a crazy long review. The one that really sticks out to me the most, believe it or not, is probably when Mickey comes over and he's talking to Rocky, and he's basically saying, you need a manager, kid. And Rocky's like, yeah, you know, where were you? And then, well, Mickey talks for, like, 5 minutes alone, and then Rocky talks for, like, 5 minutes alone, yelling at him. But, like, do you ever think a couple things about that scene? Like, if he just said to Rocky, you need training, like, I think Rocky would have taken a different, like, management. Sounds like he just wants to benefit.
He wants a piece of the pie.
Right. Instead of saying training. And then it's so interesting that you get this this confrontation between the two of them one at a time, even though Mickey really wasn't yelling, but, you know, Rocky. And then you get to this weird moment where it's like this long shot of Rocky running down the stairs and look like he's about to attack Mickey. And Mickey's like that, like, freaked out when he turns around. And he's like, he says something that we don't know. Like, why didn't they let us hear? Do you think it's because after that bizarre exchange that you couldn't wrap that up in two sentences and, like, everything's all okay now, I'll see you at the gym tomorrow? Do you think it was better left to our imaginations? Like, why do you think that was an inaudible scene?
Yes, I actually love how they did it. I love how you can't hear him. You can just see the visual of him chasing Mickey down. You can tell he feels bad. And I'm always assumed he just said something like, hey, Mickey, I'm sorry. Yes, I would love you to be my manager. And then he starts walking away and he turns around, and he sticks his hand out. They shake hands and part ways. Then they look back at each other and Mick waves at him. And all's good.
You think it was just an apology and yes, I'll be there.
Yep, exactly.
And more, it just makes it more dramatic.
Yep.
After they both had their Mickey poured his heart out, Rocky yells at him. And I love how Mickey just sort of walks away knowing, okay, I guess this is over. And then Stallone has that change of heart and goes out and chases after him. And then at that point, we know where it's kind of going. It's just, it's nice just to see it sort of play out. It's more dramatic that way.
Yeah. They had a fight. They got everything aired out. Everything was said. Okay. That's done. Let's move on. Let's do this.
Yeah, like, even the weird moment where Mickey forgot his hat and he opens the door and closes it again, and Rocky thought he left. And then he goes back and is like, oh, you're still here? And he goes back in the bathroom. Like, it was just like a lot of great stuff. What would you guys say is one is a scene that stuck out to you, Christian? What do you think?
Yeah, that you stole one of one of the big moments. That scene is, no question, like, one of the standout scenes in the film. No question. What I do like, which he kind of repeats in Rocky Balboa, is it doesn't even matter. You're hearing it in the background about, like, what this judge, like, you know, when it's a split decision, winner by split decision, and they're going through it, but it's not about that. It's about him going the distance.
Exactly.
And the, I, like, you know, Adrian, I love you. It's all about that. It's the love story. So you still get this underdog story, but it's ultimately a love story, a romance in a sense. And that's why I think it resonates so well with with a bunch of different age groups and audiences, and whether you're, you know, male, female, whatever, doesn't matter. I just think it just resonates because it's about relationships and love.
And going the distance. It was all about going the distance. He never cared about winning, never thought he would win. Then once he did, Adrian was such a focus of his that once she walked in the ring, the first thing he says, he says, "Where's your hat?" And then she just like hugs him and then says something like, "How weird that he knows." And it's weird, as a kid, I always noticed that guy knocks her hat off as she's coming down to the ring. But I never realized he said, "Where's your hat?" until I was a lot older. And then that just like, because now, you know, things sound better. It's Blu-ray, but whatever.
That just shows his innocence. Like, he noticed that, like, in all of that hubbub, he just fought his fucking guts out.
Denouncing the winner.
Fight of his life. Yeah. Denouncing the winner. And all he's focused on is, "Where's your hat?"
And again, people are asking about the rematch or whatever. You're going to do a rematch? And he's like, Adrian. And then they give Paulie a fucking great moment there where he's trying to get in. And he's his jacket's getting pulled. And he's like, hey. And she's like, Paulie. And he sees that she wants to get in there. And he lifts the ring up can get through. Yeah. Oh, it's great. It's such a good moment because they give Paulie these moments because he's a flawed person. Everybody here, like you mentioned earlier, Alex, everybody's like a bum. They're down and out. They're flawed. And that, again, I think is another draw to the movie.
And I will say, throughout the whole series, Paulie always gets his moment. And they're always right. They're always the right moment. Even when he's yelling at the bums in part three, like, there's just something about everything they give him is really... it really fleshes him out completely. And in this movie, absolutely, especially.
Invited him over for dinner, not even telling his sister, but then telling his sister to get out, even though he's a dick about it. It's for her benefit. He wants her to go out and have a good time and not be stuck in the house, even though he does it in such a
fucked up worst way possible.
Ripping a turkey out that she just cooked. Chucking it into the backyard.
He's eating the leg while he's talking. He's like, he's knocking on the door.
"You hungry, Rock?"
That's so stupid. Go on the alley and eat the bird.
"You want the bird? Go on the alley and eat the bird."
Yeah, that's great. Those are great impersonations. And there's things that I think by watching movies over and over again, some movies do this well right out of the gate, and this is a perfect example of it. Like, usually when a character's named something, they'll just call him Rocky. They establish that he has, like, Rock or whatever. I mean, it's little small, subtle things like that.
To make it feel lived in.
Yeah, and I love that about this movie, like, that he already has this relationship with him, calls him Rock. They're comfortable. He's being respectful. He goes to him to say, "Hey, what's with your sister?" Like, so there's some... there's these good moments between them. I would say another scene, but Chris hasn't been able to go say his yet. So I don't want to possibly steal his thunder of it. Cause there are so many great moments. So Chris, go ahead. What was yours?
I mean, I could name 20 different scenes in this fucking movie. I'll just do a quick combo of scenes. When Rocky gets called to the promoter's office, where they're going to offer him the fight, and he sits down and he's like, "How would you like to fight Apollo Creed?" And he's like,
He likes you.
He wants to fight you. And he's like, "I don't think you understand me, Rocky. How would you like to fight Apollo Creed for the World Heavyweight Championship?" And Rocky looks at him and looks away and says, "No." Because he knows, or he thinks, he has no business being in the ring with Apollo Creed.
Wouldn't there be a million questions like, "I'm sorry, why would you,
who am I?" First they would say, "Yes, please," because of the money. And then they'd be like, "Why me?"
Yeah, I'm sorry, how do I equate into, why would I be fighting the heavyweight champion? I'm like a local bum fighter.
And then I'll piggyback off that scene once he does accept the fight. And that news crew shows up to the meat processing place.
That was the scene I was going to talk about.
And Paulie keeps sticking out in the background.
Yeah.
And the meat man. He said the meat guy sticking his head in the cave.
The meat guy sticking his head out. So Rocky's working the meat, and they're filming him, and Apollo's trainer, Tony, is watching the TV while Apollo's bullshitting in the background, and he sees, he's watching intently, and he goes, "Hey, champ, you might want to take a look at this guy you're going against, man." And he's like, "Looks like he means business." And Apollo's like, yeah, I mean business too. And Tony turns, and he kind of looks back, and then looks back at the TV, and you can tell he sees something like, this isn't going to be a cakewalk.
It's supposed to be leading the audience to, hey, Rocky might do something here. He's not just going to get his ass kicked. You know what I mean?
Right.
And we wouldn't be watching it if we didn't suspect that anyway. But yeah, right. it's good to bring that actual to terms, and it's not just us. Sometimes it's great when, like, when we're a fly on the wall. Like, now we get to see what's going on their end of it, and Rocky doesn't know these things, and we do. And, like, that's the beauty of film, you know? It's the way the story's told. And it's just, they have, a lot of great moments like that. It's funny, this is known as a boxing movie, but honestly, there's very little boxing going on. I mean, there's just moments in the gym where you had a chance to be a, you know, a great, but instead you're a two-bit loan shark, you know, like that, which is another great moment. That's the other thing. Again, you know, when we just did the Skeleton Crew, the iconic moments in horror shows, what we realized is all the greatest movies have the most iconic moments. Like, they all have 4 or 5 or 10. Rocky, honestly, it almost feels like you can get the chills by talking about any of these scenes. Right?
For sure. And you're saying, like, even, just like the whole meat tenderizing thing is fantastic. And I love the fact that he thinks he goes, I invented it.
He goes, I invented it during dinner one
night. Yeah.
No, I invented that.
Oh, no, wait, that was his name. He invented the Italian Stallion during dinner one night, he says.
You could take that scene. You could take, like, the iconic movie, which is a cliche, and maybe even at this point was already used, but it was kind of like a nod to some older films from before then, with the taking off the glasses and suddenly the shy, ugly ducking, so to speak.
Yeah, like, she's all that.
Yeah, exactly. She's all that.
They did it, she's all that before
it's the
she's
same
all that.
Shit, dude. Yeah. Take the glasses off. Whoa!
They're like, you know what? Rocky's so good. We could take one aspect of this movie and make a whole movie based off it. Well, let's pick one. Yeah. the weird rapey scene. Okay, let's do it.
him training, like this is the early Rocky. So he gets up. You can tell he's just exhausted. He goes to he literally cracks, what, five or six eggs into the blender.
And fucking holes in it. I mean,
yeah.
It's freezing outside.
And he's not doing so well. Like, he can barely do the run. He's like, he's running, but he's hurting.
His sides hurt, yeah.
You feel it. Like, you're right there with them.
Oh, yeah, when he's jogging, you can feel the cold when he's jogging.
Hell yeah.
You feel like you're jogging with him. It's a strange moment. The way it's shot is very interesting. I don't know this other guy's work, but the director, I mean, he really, it must be like a 70s thing too, though. The way things are captured, the way they're framed, the way it's told through the cinematography. This is the other thing about this movie, why it's Rocky. Everything is right. Like, every aspect, the music, the cinematography, everything.
Well, I was about to compare this, because you're talking about the nuances of showing the other side. And I was like, it's kind of like Cobra Kai. We're so used to seeing the Karate Kid and then seeing it from a different perspective and seeing Cobra Kai. Well, guess what? This director directed the first Karate Kid, which is kind of funny as well. And he also directed Joe. Those are the two movies, and Rocky V. Those are the movies I know of. I'm sure he has a much larger filmography, but without jumping on IMDb and laundry listing it off, those are the ones that come to mind. So that Joe movie, if I'm not mistaken, again, taking place there, it's a slice of life. He seems to be able to just capture that on screen, and he does it well here. But what I like, and what we were talking about when I was trying to make that relationship with the Karate Kid and the Cobra Kai, is that you're getting that side here. You're getting the perspective of Apollo Creed and his side. Not a lot. It'd be awesome to do a whole movie from that angle of it, but we get enough scenes that we get a taste of, like, he's egotistical, He's not against putting in the work. He's put in the work, but he's kind of like, this is a publicity stunt, something that evolves with his character as the series goes on. So it's already rooted here, but he kind of undermines the fact that this Palooka is gonna beat the pulp out of him later.
Yeah, it's funny. Karate Kid is really Rocky for kids, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that makes sense. Yeah. The music. We talked about this with Halloween, right? When music marries the screen that well, there's something to be said here. And, like, it's perfection, right? Like, nothing else could be over this movie. Nothing.
How about the title coming across the screen at the beginning? Yeah. Iconic, right? Like a Star Wars moment. You think Star Wars? You think Rocky? Dun, 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 dun. And going to fly now. Like this is, you're right. It's married to the movie. You can put going to fly now in any other movie. You couldn't. It belongs to this. Or
another weird tie-in. Rocky III was supposed to have "You're the best around, nothing's ever gonna," and instead they did "Eye of the Tiger."
Exactly. So,
and think about this: neither one of those would have worked in the other one, and they are perfect for where they were. Some things are just supposed to be what they became, and there's no fighting it. And Rocky is a perfect example.
It is incredible what music in movies, and specifically these movies, what that can invoke in you if it's married to the right visuals.
Absolutely.
I mean, my God.
And
every single one of these movies, with the possible exception of Part 5, the music in these movies is just so emotional. It gets me every time, and I know it's as much, if not more, because of the music than it is what I'm seeing on screen. Now, it's the perfect blending of the two, but that music is just fucking next level, man.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
It's not just good for the movie. It's just great music. It's so inspirational.
Oh, yes.
And to think that the guy did it for this movie is so weird, because think about it. Without it, the movie's not as remarkable, honestly. Like, just like Halloween, when John Carpenter said,
yeah,
he showed it to executives, and they said, it's kind of boring. So then all of a sudden the music was in it, and all of a sudden it's like, that's the greatest horror movie ever made. You know, like Rocky, honestly, it is what it is because of that music. I mean, how many people point the music out above everything? Like, oh yeah, like, everyone knows this. I mean, this is like, this transcends movie going. This, you don't even have to know the movies and you know this.
Absolutely. Yeah, even if you don't know what it's from, if you play that clip for somebody, they know what it is, even if they're younger and they're like, they can't say Rocky, they know that music.
They know it. Yeah.
Yeah.
The dawn of an icon, and he played two icons. Maybe you could say more, but like, let's, in pop culture, let's say Rocky and Rambo are two icons. And right. I've said Han Solo is the other one that comes to mind. There've been others now, but it's like he knew he had something, when they're doing this, they weren't thinking it was going to go on necessarily forever. It was this, and then maybe a follow-up. And again, I don't know the ins and outs of how the follow-up came to be, other than the first one was so successful, and then he wasn't maybe having success, and maybe we'll get to that. But it's such a great continuation of the story as well.
Oh, it is, right? That's the other thing. The sequels were so good. Like, how were they good? And here's the other thing. Okay, so the big question, how are they good? But the real question is, why aren't all sequels good, right? Because think about it. What's your favorite TV show ever? Like modern, like Game of Thrones or Sons of Anarchy or whatever. Like, what's your favorite one in the last 10 years?
If I had to pick one out right out of the gate, like just quickly, I'd say The Bear. But that's just because it's the last two seasons. The only Breaking two seasons, Bad. But it's been great.
So haven't you watched 5 or 6 or 10 episodes in a row and they're all amazing?
Yeah.
Yeah, you could do 10 episodes of a show, but you can't do 2 movies in a row that are good. You know, like, it almost makes you wonder, why aren't all movies as good as Rocky movies? Like, how do you screw up by the third one, and then the fourth one sucks? And then you kind of came back with the fifth one, and then the sixth one is horrible. Like, I feel like every movie should be as good as the Rocky sequels, because you have all this time, you have all this money, you have all these writers. How could any movie be bad, right? It's kind of weird, because how could you make hundreds of TV shows in a row that are great, but then you can't get through two movies? They're only 90 minutes. It's not that hard. Yeah. You know, like, it's a weird thing, but we all know it doesn't happen like that. Most movie sequels suck, and it's a strange thing, but yeah, the Rocky sequels, I'm excited to talk about those. Those are all amazing, but all right, so let's get to the boxing portion, because that's what these movies really are, right? Sort of. They're boxing movies. So the fight, I mean, my God, the choreography on these fights, so interesting. Every moment, and it's weird, if you watch behind the scenes, when I used to watch these fights, I always thought these little nuances were just great moments captured on tape. No. Every single movement virtually was planned.
They rehearsed the shit out of these fight scenes. Down to the punches.
Yeah,
like
right to the punches. Oh, yeah.
Over and over.
The punches matched what was on screen when I was watching the behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, they put a lot of thought into this. And it's like a beautiful dance. It really is. And what always bothered me as a kid about the Rocky fights, I will admit, it's because you're a kid, you want more of it. So it kind of always bugged me when they just kept panning to the lady with the number, holding up the number, and it kept going through the rounds. Like, no, I want to see those rounds too. Like, don't just go through the rounds. What are you doing? So, like, you always get the first round, right, where it kind of establishes this or that. Rocky gets his one lucky punch. Then the second round, Rocky starts. Then you say, oh, wait, he actually could beat the guy. Then the third round kind of, like, blends to the fourth, and all of a sudden it's a bunch of numbers. Then we get to the last one. Or the second to last sometimes, right?
So at the end of the second round, Rocky's got Apollo on the ropes and is battering him. Round ends. They get separated. Then it cuts to that ring card girl. Round three. Fades to round five. Fades to round seven. And that's showing you, oh shit.
He's making it through.
He's sticking around. He's not going anywhere. And then it cuts back to the boxing.
Right. And then we get to the second to last and then last. So how about that moment, though, when Rocky lays his ass out and it cuts to the bar, the local bar, and the guy slams down the rag and they're all screaming? Tell me that does not just make the blood rush through your body.
It's been copied so many times, and it works in all movies that do it. And it's probably, I'm trying to think, I can't think of a movie before this that may have done that. It may have started here, and it's amazing.
Perspectives are everything. Like, even choosing, instead of having, like, the weigh-in for these two guys, to have this moment where they're together, instead they do it with a press conference. But not only do they do the press conference, they choose to show Rocky and everyone watching it because it was pre-taped.
Yeah.
Think of that choice. Right? How amazing is that? Because it's like, it's just a little moment, right? But doesn't it play so differently when Rocky's there watching and you get Adrian's immediate reaction because she wasn't there and you see...
Is she so excited for him?
Yeah.
And then he goes, if he can't fight, I bet he could cook. And then he goes, you know what I said? It didn't bother me. And he goes, it did or whatever. Like it's so interesting.
And that's a great moment. You know what I said? It didn't bother me none. It did. And then that soft music kicks in and it's like, again, perfect. It shows the emotion that he's feeling at that point. He's scared, but he's pissed. It's just like all this swirling.
And not to go back, I know we're in the fight, but how can we not address the moment when they're laying in bed and he's talking about going the distance?
Yeah.
Dude.
And that's it, because he ends up being able to do it. We talked about it a bit earlier. The only question that I've got left is probably, do you think Paulie got his $250 worth?
I would think so. In whiskey, yeah. Oh, Paulie, he is amazing. And unfortunately, we can't talk about him as much as we'd like. You know, we are going to address him every movie, but he is just amazing. And even though he's the biggest asshole in the world in this movie, somehow, like, even Is this the movie? Yeah, yeah. When the news people, they just go, I'm going to kill you, Paulie. Like, and then he starts laughing and everything. Like, you could see how you can't stay mad at this guy, right?
Right.
Yeah. Like, it's so funny. Like,
and that's that documentary feeling you're talking about, Chris, yeah, earlier. It's like, they just happen to capture these moments, which is acting, but it doesn't seem like
it. It just feels so real.
Yeah.
It's bizarre. It's bizarre a world, this Rocky stuff. That's why I'm so glad we're talking about it.
Just to cut in real quick, my favorite moment of the final, or of the fight at the end, is at the end of the 14th round, when Apollo finally drops him. Apollo goes back to his corner. He's got his hands up. He thinks the fight's over. Rocky slowly climbs up, turns around and goes, come on. Apollo looks at his corner, shakes his head, and like, are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah.
Slowly walks back over there. Rocky's crouched in the corner. Apollo swings again, misses. Rocky ducks, cups, comes under. It starts smashing Apollo into the body.
Apollo's bottom lip thing or whatever is like bulging out. Maybe the mouthpiece is doing it. Ugh.
And you can just hear when he's hitting Apollo with those last few body shots at the end of that round, you can hear Apollo just the pain that he's in because his ribs are broken and it's like he can't take it anymore.
Oh yeah, he tenderizes them too. We have to mention, I know we're running long, but we do have to mention the cut me Mick. Yeah, because I love playing punch out when I was young, and I always I always looked like fucking punch out. But also, although you can see the blood kind of shoot out of the guy's hand when they do the tubing,
right,
there,
right.
I'm forgiving of it. It's the fact that they cut his eye open to do it, because that plays into where a piece of plot or story for part two and beyond as well. So I figured it was worth bringing up.
Yeah, it does.
And then just to recap, the fight's over, goes the distance, crowd's going nuts. Adrian runs in the ring. You can hear the ring announcer in the background if you're listening closely, but I love how they don't focus on the fact that Apollo wins the fight. You can hear it, and you see Apollo put his hands up when they announce the one scorecard for him, but at the scene when Rocky and Adrian are like, she goes, I love you, and he goes, I love you, in the background you hear, and still heavyweight champion of the, and but it's in the background because they're like, don't even focus. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, the focus, what we're supposed to focus on, is over.
And let's not forget, there'll be no rematch. Don't want one. Money talks.
Oh, yeah. I love that. And then it...
Like, again, the music.
Perfect music. And none of the music's not perfect. Like...
No!
Even the slow, like, just the piano, like you said, when he said, it did bother me.
The piano, every time that piano kicks in, just softly, it's just like, it just hits so hard. It's incredible.
And again, let's talk about, maybe we're doing the part two. We'll just talk about the casting, right? Like, how about that, guys? Don't worry if this is too short. We can maybe paint little strokes throughout this thing to fill in stuff we can't do right away. But again, we just don't want to make this really long because we have so many movies to do. We want to keep it tight. But we're going to get into like the perfect casting, because thank God, guess what, guys? In part two, they're all there.
Yes.
And that's what also makes the sequel so amazing, right? Think about how many movies have sequels.
True Blue sequel. Yeah.
Think about how many ones where someone didn't show up or whatever.
Yep.
And I'll talk about that when we hit part two, because that's one of the best aspects of how the first four movies string together. I'm not saying it didn't happen in five, but like
it did happen in five. They brought Mickey back.
Well, yes, true. Yeah, yeah.
So interesting. But Apollo, yeah, right. But hey, we all got to go sometime, right? So, let's rate this movie. Christian, how do you rate this from out of five? How many turkeys in an alleyway are you giving this movie?
This is one of those series that I don't even think it's nostalgia, because I'm watching them now and I'm loving it. It's a five. That's my short answer. It's a five. And we're going to be hearing this a lot throughout the series.
Yeah, we are. How about you, Chris?
Give it a 4.25. No, I'm just kidding. Come on. It's a 20 out of 5. I fucking love it.
Yeah, I also, 5 out of 5, it's a Hall of Famer for sure. I don't think anyone who knows this movie or really has an appreciation for great cinema would ever give this movie lower than a 5. What could possibly have made this more perfect? Nothing, honestly. I couldn't think of a single thing. Maybe another 30 seconds of boxing would be nice, but I don't think that matters. So, yep, 5 out of 5. That was Rocky 1976. So tune in next week while we go for the sequel, Rocky 2.